Bundys Garage, Bundy here. Today we're working on a 2000 Honda Accord with a J-Series V6. We're going to be doing the valve cover gaskets on this vehicle. First thing you want to do is remove this cover. There's four 10mm bolts that hold this thing on. Loosen those up and we'll get those out of the way. I got me this handy dandy metal magnetic tray for bolts and parts for my good buddies at O'Reilly. Another thing I got was this magnetic pickup tool. And the cool thing with this is it has a light. There you go, see? Not only does it pick stuff up, but when you're searching down there in the nooks and crannies, you can see what you're looking for. Pull straight up. Go ahead, pull that out and get that out of the way. So I'll loosen up all the coil packs for the spark plugs. Right here, just squeeze this side of the coil pack. At the same time, pull the plug up. You'll do that for the back as well. It's a little bit tighter here in the back, but just reach your hand back here and you'll be able to see it. Right back here, there's a coil pack. There's three of them. To get this out, that tab right there has to be depressed. And while you depress it, you pull up on the plug and you work it out. All right, just like that. Okay, work that out. And then we'll work this third and final one out way over here. Helps if you have smaller hands. But basically, yeah, that's what you do. This clip right here needs to be depressed while you pull up on the connector to disconnect from the coil pack. Okay, working on this last one over here. Get your hand in there. Basically, I brought in my two hands. One hand was, my middle finger was pushing on the tab, and my other hand was pushing on the, was pulling up the connector at the same time. Next thing we'll do is get all these coil packs out, both sides, the front and the back. This is a 6mm hex that you need to use to remove the spark, to remove the coil packs. These front ones are easy to do. It's the rear ones that you're going to have the problem, not a problem with, just a little bit more effort to get the bolt loose. Typically, you're not going to be able to use a socket or a wrench, I should say, back there because it's so confined. So you might just have to come in there with a Allen key to get the bolts out, get the coil packs free. Work all three bolts out, and we'll pull the coil packs and go ahead and pull these coil packs out and come straight out. The front ones are easy to do. It's the rear ones that we're going to have to worry about. Not worry about, but just a little bit more of a hassle. So here's the key I'm going to use, the hex key. It's a 6mm. If you notice, this and my socket are both painted yellow. What I like to do, and it's just my own little thing that I do, I will go to Lowe's and get Farmer Yellow, I believe it's called. Farm Equipment Yellow Spray Paint. Basically, obviously, it's in there. Paint division behind a gate because people are sniffing it. But what I'll do is I'll get some tools and just spray them this color. Reason being is I've lost a fair amount of tools because they come black and it's just hard to see when it's laying down an engine. But if something's yellow, it's a little bit easier to spot when you're doing your dummy check at the end. What I mean is by a dummy check is checking up there on the variants for tools, also checking near the radiator down there that the shop ran into a couple times where full rails of snap-on sockets were left inside the vehicle. Found one between the radiator and the core support. And it was a free Christmas gift to me, but felt bad for the guy who lost it. Wasn't a cheap loss. So, just like we did on the front, we're going to come back here, loosen up the 6mm bolts that are holding on the coil packs. So just go through, loosen all these up. And I'm also going to show you a trick for getting the throttle body off, where you do not have to take all the air system cleaner out. It's four bolts and your throttle body is free. Worst case scenario, you need a throttle body gasket, but typically those don't deteriorate and come apart, but you might need it. Reason we're doing the valve covers on this T 2000 Honda Accord is the fact that they are leaking. This rear one is leaking like a sieve, has a bad oil leak. Every time she drives the vehicle, she smells oil, burning oil. Jacked the car up, went under there, looked, and you could see oil on the backside hitting the exhaust manifold, just burning up. So it stinks inside the vehicle. And it's also a fire hazard. If it gets bad enough, that oil can actually catch on fire and burn the vehicle to the ground. And I have seen that happen. A buddy of mine had an old Jeep, and he was off-roading it, and had an oil leak. He didn't fix it. And it got bad enough to the point where it burned the vehicle to the ground, caught on fire, oil caught on fire, and burned the whole vehicle down. Moral of the story is, fix those oil leaks. Don't let them get out of hand. And it wasn't even his, it was his dad's. He was out with a girl. That's gotta look bad for a first date, huh? So there's a clip here. I should say a 10 millimeter bolt that's holding on high pressure power steering hose. Gonna go ahead and remove that. Get a standard wrench in there and pop that bolt loose. It's right there where my finger's pointing. There's a 10 millimeter bolt. Where my finger's pointing right there, there's a 10 millimeter bolt that holds this hose on. The high side of the power steering pump. So just getting a 10 millimeter wrench, just loosening that up. Grab my key, my 6 millimeter hex key. That right there. We'll go in here, break this one loose. Okay. All 6 bolts for the coil packs are loose. We're that much closer to getting to the valve cover gaskets. Okay, pull these straight up and out. Maneuver them around if you have to get them out completely. There's one of the back ones. There's 2 of the back ones. And here's 3 of the back ones. It looks like an old piece of rubber. I don't mean that kind of rubber, you sickos. What I'm going to do now, and this is a trick I was telling you about to get the throttle body off. I'm not going to take any of this stuff off. I'm not going to take the throttle control cable. I'll probably disconnect these sensors. But basically what you're going to do is there's 4 12 millimeter bolts. There's one here, one on the bottom from below this bolt, and one below on the other side as well. So what you're going to do is you're going to loosen up all 4 bolts. And then we're going to loosen up the intake manifold, the plenum. And we're going to work. There's 2 studs on this. The rest are bolts. And you're going to pull from this side, from passenger side up. And you're going to pull the whole assembly out as one whole piece. So let me show you how to do that. So first, let's loosen up these 4 12 millimeter bolts that hold on the throttle body. And you might be able to use your ratchet and socket, and you might need to use a 12 millimeter wrench. I'm going to use this wrench that I got. It's a snap-on. It's a 0 offset wrench. It has a 10 millimeter on this side, a 12 millimeter on that side. But the thing that's really cool about these wrenches is the fact that the head, not only being 0 offset, so it's totally flat and straight, but the head has this little ridge, a little bit longer than a normal wrench would have. So you can go in there and grab the edge of a bolt. These are great when you're doing a timing belt, loosening up all the bolts on the side. I would not even consider doing a timing belt job without these tools in my hand. Love them. I'll put a link in the description below where you can buy a whole set for, I think, like $80. Definitely worth it if you're going to be doing a lot of work on your Hondas or Toyotas or Acuras or Lexus. The top ones are nuts. You can see right there. Oh, I dropped it. Hit the ground. I'll worry about that after I get this off. There's one right here. And then directly across is the other one. That's another 12 millimeter. I need a 12 millimeter short because it's not sitting on there correctly. I don't want to run the risk of rounding out that bolt. Okay, broke that one loose. The top two are nuts. The bottom two are bolts. On one side, you're not going to be able to pull it out all the way because it'll be blocked. So your best bet will be just to leave it there and then pull the plenum off. So you can see it right there. Go ahead, we'll take this one off. Reason I do this is it makes it so much more easy than trying to pull all the stuff that's on the throttle body away and free. You don't have to worry about the throttle cable or the snorkel or any of the wiring. You just basically leave the throttle body in place as you remove the plenum. And that wrench is on the bolt that you need to remove. So this would be the lower bolt on the throttle body closest towards the firewall. I have a 12 millimeter wrench on there that I'm going to break it loose with. Sorry for the shaky camera work. See if I can do it right here. Or I might have to go down a little bit farther. Okay. Ooh, that sucker's on there tight. Okay. Got it free. This is the one that's not going to come out. This is the one that you're going to basically pull out a little bit. And then just leave it there. I mean, it'll be loosened away from the plenum enough to do it, but you're not going to be able to pull the bolt all the way out and free and clear like the other ones. Right there, you can see the bolt. It's out. You're not going to be able to clear it past everything that's in the way, so just leave it like that. As you pull the plenum out, that bolt will be free, so don't worry about that. I just wanted you guys to see a look and see how that, take a look and see how that looks. Right here is where it's going to separate from the plenum upper intake. This is your throttle body. There's a gasket right here. If that gasket rips, go ahead, run to any parts store, grab yourself a new one. Make sure that seals correctly because you don't want to have a vacuum leak and a check engine light be set after you do the job. So if this rips, go ahead and replace it. Next, we have all the bolts out of the throttle body. Now we will take all the bolts out of the plenum. So you can see right there, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 bolts that need to be removed. They are 12 millimeter. Let's get you set up to stand next to me as I do this. And we'll take off the plenum. We'll also have to take off this clip right here. That basically you squeeze this together and it comes off. So pull that off. There's a clip right there. Go ahead, squeeze that and it comes off. Then you're gonna have these hoses that are right here. It's held on by 2 10 millimeter bolts, one right here, one over there. So you can just take those 2 10 millimeter bolts, remove those, and all these three hoses will come out at the same time. Don't run the risk of pulling these off one by one, because after time they get brittle and they can crack on you. That's just something you don't want. Also know that there's a gasket between this flange and the plenum. So just be careful when you remove it and when you install it that you put that gasket back into place. Okay, now that we have the throttle body free and clear, not free and clear, but all the bolts out of the throttle body, I should say, we're going to go ahead and remove all these bolts and nuts from the upper intake plenum. So, there is a torque sequence to this when you put it back on, but when you remove it, it doesn't really matter. So, this is a 12 millimeter, these are all 12 millimeter. There's three nuts. Okay, three nuts. Two over here and one on the other side, on the passenger side. So three nuts and the rest are bolts. Next thing you're going to want to do is go ahead, loosen up that those three lines in the back. Loosen this up. Okay, there's one of them. That's what it looks like. On the other side, another 10 millimeter. I'm starving. You get some chow. Okay, like I said, there is a gasket back there, and I'll show you right now. Right here is the gasket. You can see it goes only on one way. You'll be able to tell it. There's indentation of where it belongs, but it's metal, so don't lose it. Make sure you put it back on there when you put everything back together, because if you don't, you're going to have some air vacuum leak or something. Okay, like I was saying earlier before, we're going to start here on this side, away from the throttle body. You're going to pull this up, and in one swift motion, you're going to pull this up and pull this whole plenum towards the passenger side. All right, make sure everything's disconnected. Good there, good there, good there. There you go. Oh man, I'm still connected. Looks like I have one last hose I forgot about. Yep, right here in the back. Just wiggling that off. There it is. PCV hose. Now your plenum's free. Place this on its back. Right here is the gasket for the plenum, the upper intake manifold. Don't lose that, just leave that in place. Next thing, best practice, what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna get a rag, a towel, an old shirt. I'm gonna place it in here because these lead right in, this is the intake, right into your cylinder. So you don't wanna drop anything down there. No foreign material whatsoever. You don't want anything down there. You want it nice and clean when you put it all back together. Place the rag over there. It's better to get a rag, that way you can shove it into the last hole and the first hole, and then keep that protected. Try to stay away from paper towel, because if you have a paper towel, it could rip, or you could get grease on this, or gasoline, worst case scenario, and then it'll just deteriorate and come apart. Right here is your fuel pressure regulator. Right here are your connectors for your injectors. This is your fuel rail, injector connectors. Right below the fuel rail is your injectors. So right here, we're gonna take these valve covers off. We need to loosen up these connectors that hold the wiring harness for the coil packs. So let's do this side first. Two 10 millimeter bolts. Looks like holds that thing on. These two. Maybe that's 12. No, it's 10. Okay, that one's loose. That one's loose. Move your wiring harness out of the way, just flipping that up and over. I'm actually gonna put these bolts back in place. Sometimes that's the best place to put them so you don't lose them. Right here is a hose clamp. So I'll get my Crescent X pliers out. Squeeze that together. Bring that up out of the way. And this hose is pretty old and worn out for a 2000 Honda Accord. So trying to slip that under, break the seal loose, work it around just in a circular motion, and then I'll try to pull this whole thing back and out of the way. There we go. Okay, so that's free. Doesn't look like there's anything else holding up the valve cover. Looks like they're tens. Yeah, you know what, I'm gonna grab a 3/8 ratchet instead of a quarter inch on these. Let's go that much easier. It's the back valve cover that's leaking on this J-Series V6 Honda Accord. But while you're here, why not do both of them? I got the valve cover gaskets from rockauto.com. Great prices, shipped directly to my house. Then the last 10 millimeter bolt. Man, Honda loves using 10, 12, 14, 17, and 19 millimeter bolts on their vehicles. So I came here on the side with a screwdriver. Right here, there's a little ridge that you can grab. Looks like this gasket has been so tight after all that I just needed to pry it up a little bit. It's just that this gasket has been on here for long time. Looks like it's free. Man. So there you go. Okay, so there's different length bolts here. This is the size of the one in the back. This is the size of the one in the front. So you can see the difference in size. Long. The front two are long. This side is long, and I bet this side is long too. Yep, that one's long too. Okay, so there you go, there's the old gasket. Hard as a rock, not as hard as a rock, but pretty hard. Man, does not want to come out easily, huh? Let's go wash this thing off real quick. Alright, I just took a can of brake clean to the valve cover. Piece of aluminum. Try to clean up as best I can. Looks a little bit better. If I had time, I would paint it. I'd paint it yellow. Alright, we're going to replace these seals inside of here as well. These are the tube seals. Here's part of the old gasket. Pretty hard and unmovable. And then we have this gasket to take care of as well right here. Some of it is stuck in there, so I'm gonna have to work a little bit harder to get it out. Does not want to come out. And it breaks apart. So next we'll do the same tool that I used to get the hose off. Go ahead, stick it in here. Try to work it out. The remaining gasket, valve cover gasket. So I'm gonna take this to the bench, pop these off, pull this out, and we'll go from there. All right, with my tool, just working the remainder of this seal out, little by little. Try not to damage the aluminum valve cover as you're doing it. Don't want to harm that in any way. Just trying to pick it off like a piece of plaque. Okay, there. Okay, right down here, there's some, so I'm going to try to get that off. That comes off fairly easy. Okay, get a rag. Just run it into the rail. The area where the gasket sits, I'm just running it around, stuffing some of the paper towel in, just trying to clean it up. Next thing we're going to do, I'm going to pop these out. Just note which way they go in. Taking my same hose tool and just trying to work it up. So as you can see, this is how it sits. This is how it came out. That's the bottom. So the raised edge facing towards you. Once we have all those popped out, we'll go in here, clean this up a little bit. Make sure there's no foreign debris that hinders the new seal going into place. To get those in, it'll probably be best to maybe to put some grease on there. Man, those are hard. We're gonna have to do the same thing to the other valve cover as well. Good thing I got a couple cans of brake clean here to clean them up. Get all the all the oil out of there, clean them up, get them ready for the new seals. Got this from rockauto.com, 036-1789, Beck Arnley. Has the two valve cover gaskets, has these oil tube seals, and then right here are the seals for the bolts on the top side. So you'll put these down before you put the bolts in the, back into place. Okay, gonna try to press these in. Got some Lucas assembly lube here. Good stuff, I love this stuff. High performance assembly lube. So what I'll do is I'll just take it, put a little dab here, a little dab there, and a little dab there. Then I'll run it around with my finger. Get it ready for the new seal. I might need to get a socket or something to push this into place. I'm not sure yet. Rub some here on the outer edge and the lip. Do you guys know why they make manholes, street manholes, round? Because it won't fall in on itself. Hopefully one quick blow and it'll go in there. I'm not that lucky. I'm gonna try to freeze these for a little bit. I'm gonna stick them in the freezer, see if they'll contract, and if they do, it should go in that much more easily. Next will be to get the rear valve cover off. Last time I left you, you saw me struggling with the oil seals, the oil tube oil seals on the top of the valve cover. Man, I will show you the trick to that. Kind of a hassle. We'll take out the PCV valve, put that aside. Okay, we have this disconnected, so that's there. Bring the wiring harness. We'll let that hang down there, okay. We have two 10 millimeter bolts right there. Plastic cover. It's actually the plastic cover for the wiring harness. So just like on the other valve cover, these are the two bolts that I left inside. Or not left inside, but left attached to the valve cover just so I could find it easier next time. Two bolts there. So we'll go ahead and put these back just so I know how to find them. Get two cans of brake clean before you do this job so you can go ahead and clean the valve cover. I used one whole can of brake clean on one valve cover. So I plan to use one whole can of brake clean on the next. So right here, these oil seals. The kit comes with new ones, so make sure you get the old ones out. Okay, that one's loose. There's only 5 10 millimeter bolts that hold this valve cover on. Double check your wiring. That's out of the way. So there we go, right along here. There's a big old oil leak. Oh yeah, it's flat as a pancake. Flat, 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 flat. I tried engine oil and assembly lube, but that just wasn't cutting it. It wasn't slippery enough. So I bought this from Lowe's, 10-3 of 2009, and I've had it that long. It's DuPont Teflon multi-use dry wax lubricant. I sprayed that on the new one, and then I used the old kingpin, which is basically a thick piece of steel, to lay it on top and pound it into place. After I started it, I came back with a 30 millimeter socket, like this one right here, and placed it on top of the new one and pounded it in with a hammer. Where the gasket sits, you want to make sure that that mating surface is clean. There is some residual. You can see right there, there's black residual gasket that's left over. That needs to be scraped off before you put the new one on. So get a scraper, or you can get a razor blade and clean that off. But be very careful of this edge right here. These two edges, this is just a piece of aluminum, and it's kind of like a sharp razor blade. So if you run your finger across this too quickly, you could end up cutting yourself very badly, so just be careful of that. All right, so make sure that the whole mating surface, the top and the bottom, is clean before you put on the new gasket. The gasket will actually sit inside the new, inside the groove of the valve cover, so we need to get this out. And I'm not gonna be able to get that out with my finger. So I just wanted to show you guys that, that you need to clean the surface on the head before putting the valve cover with the new gasket on. So let's get this gasket out. I'm gonna get my hook tool here, pry this up. This is probably the original gasket in this 2000 Honda Accord V6. Try not to stab my finger. This one is a lot worse than the one in the front. Just coming apart in pieces. Well, boys and girls, I'm gonna sign off for a couple minutes because you probably don't want to watch me do this, but your goal here will be to get the old gasket out by any means necessary. I cleaned up both valve covers. As you can see, this is the front one, this is the rear one. I used about a can of brake clean on each one. In the kit, you get new seals for the bolts. These are new seals, so when you put in the bolts again, tighten it down, you're gonna put the seals right here and then put the bolt through. It took about a can of brake clean per valve, so just make sure you have some brake clean in hand. So I went around it, and that second seal was a pain in the booty to get out. Just making sure it's clean and no major parts of the old gasket are in place. I got the seals, the top, the oil tube seals in place. This, my friends, is probably the most difficult part of the whole job. Had to bang them in. Like I had said earlier, I had to use a old kingpin from a Class A truck, an over-the-road truck, looks like that. And then I also used a 30 millimeter socket to get them in. Hopefully, for the next valve cover, it'll go a little bit easier because I have frozen them. I'm gonna use a little bit more grease. So I'm gonna place in the valve cover seal itself. It's already preformed, so just start laying it down into place. Possibly start with the corners where they're already formed. Don't stretch this, just lay it into place. Just work it around, take your time. Push it into place, lay it down. Don't drag it, because if you drag it with your finger, if you grab an edge and just start running your finger, you're gonna stretch the gasket out. So the gasket, the O-ring. So just lay it down, push it into place. Just going around, making sure everything's seated correctly. Okay, feels good. This one's ready for installation. I popped all the old ones out. Got the hammer, got the kingpin, got the 30 millimeter socket. I have a can of grease right here, Mobile One synthetic, that I'll actually apply to here, as well as the new oil tube seal. This seal I just pulled from the freezer, so I'm hoping it's just shrank just a little bit to help me get this thing in. So I'll take some grease here, apply it to the inside of where the seal sits. Okay, get some more, apply it to the outside here. And once I put this into place, I'm actually gonna bring in the kingpin and try to push it into place. I saw a guy use his hands to push these into place, but I don't know how he did that. Maybe he was extremely lucky. So you don't want that to happen. So you can see one edge went in, one edge is sticking out. You basically want to try to have this whole seal go in at the same time, at the same speed. Try to make it as slippery as possible. Like I said, this was the hardest part of the whole job. Get a piece of wood right here. Okay, put that into place. Bring in the kingpin. See if I can get it to seat all correctly at one time. Looks like it took. Okay, that side's in. This side has started. So I'll bring in my socket here and finish it off this way. So make sure when you pound this down, this lip right here, this metal lip, you're flush with the metal lip. So this side has a little bit more to go. Right here is a high spot. My hands is all slippery. Okay, looks good. I'm going to leave it right there. Maybe a little bit more on this side. Okay, feels good. So maybe putting them in the freezer overnight helped them shrink that, just help them shrink that much more to get it started. I'm using a little piece of wood, kind of just to... The valve cover is shaped an odd way, and it doesn't really sit flat when it's on a flat surface, or I should say these, where the seals go into, does not sit flat. So I'm putting this piece of wood just to raise it that much more and stop it from having to travel farther when you're pounding the seal in. So when you're setting these in the, when you're setting these into place, just make sure that you're seated flat, because when you drive it in, you want it to go in as straight as possible. Got my wood under there, bring in the kingpin. Also, make note of this metal shield on the back. The kingpin has a tendency to want to hit that. So I'm just spacing it just a little bit farther away on the back side. Okay, here we go. 1, 2, 3. Okay, it went in evenly. That's the best one I've done so far. Okay, bring in my 30 millimeter socket, finish it off. Next thing we'll do is put the last oil tube seal in, put the valve cover on, and start putting everything back together. The valves, the backlash on the valves, on the intake and exhaust valves are all taken care of. Make sure you don't forget these. There is a torque sequence for these valve covers. There's also a torque spec. So I'll share that with you next. And then I'll probably cut you guys loose. Because once you're far in, this into it, you can figure everything else out. I won't show you putting the throttle body into place. That's pretty self-explanatory. Make sure you hook up all the lines, all the air lines, all the sensors. Put the plenum back into place. Oh yeah, that's one thing I need to show you, the plenum. There's a torque spec for that and a torque sequence for that as well. Make sure it seats correctly. Like I said, the hardest part of this whole job was putting those oil seals in place. Okay, that one's in place. So next thing we'll do, we'll get the bolts. Make sure everything's clear on the back. There's nothing holding it up. Okay, looks good. This rubber grommet, this rubber O-ring, I should say, is rock hard. So I have to separate this metal top from this rubber bottom. They do separate. And then probably have to cut the rubber O-ring off to get access to it. Yeah, see, so they separated right there. And then this rubber part is just too hard to get off. Just make note of which way these, how these things sit. It's really not hard. So get a pair of dykes, cut these open, cut them off. Once you cut it off, you'll be able to work it out and put the new one on. So I cut right through it. Just pry it off. This metal part comes right off too. All of them are long. All five bolts are long except for this very front one. So go ahead and start that. Make sure that's seated correctly. Just feel with your hand. Like I said, start them by hand. You're going to leave all of them loose until they're all started by hand. Don't start this with an air gun or a socket. Just use your hands. Because if you use a gun or a socket, you run the risk cross-threading it. That's something you really don't want to do. Just go around, cut all the old O-rings off of the bolts, install the new ones. Okay, next thing we're going to do, I'm this far into it, so I'm actually going to adjust the valve lash, adjust the valves. These are the rocker arms right here. This is the intake side. This is the exhaust, okay? I'll put a diagram of how each cylinder numbers, but here in the first corner, on the back side, closest to the passenger side, that's cylinder number one, and then just imagine going back and away from it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so back there, right back here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Cylinder 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. You don't need to remove the front passenger side tire to do this. All you need is to get access to the crankshaft, because you're going to actually turn the crankshaft to each individual cylinder, and that's how you adjust the exhaust and intake valves. So I just have a long half inch breaker bar that comes out to a 19 millimeter impact socket, and then a wrench. You can see right here. So this engine actually turns clockwise. So then once you do that, on this top front cover for the timing belt, there's a window. Basically has this little rubber grommet in place, but you just move that out of the way, get that out of the way, and there's a window into the numbering on the, basically the numbering for what cylinder you're going to be working on. So it goes 1 through 6. So you rotate your 19 millimeter crankshaft pulley bolt and then line up with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Whatever number is corresponding through the window is what cylinder you're going to adjust next. So if you're working on cylinder number 4, you'd be adjusting the intake and exhaust valves on this cylinder right here. Intake, exhaust. Intake's closer to the intake. Exhaust is closer to your exhaust. So right down there, hopefully you can see it, to the top left-hand corner, there's number 5. So that means you're going to work on cylinder number 5. So just open up that window, line up to the corresponding cylinder, and that's the intake and exhaust valve that you're going to be working on. We're going to work on cylinder number 4. So don't forget, 4, 5, 6. Cylinder number 4, I'm going to rotate the engine around right now until I see number 4 pop up. But you're going to repeat this step 6 times to do this. On the cover itself, you'll see a mark on the inside, and you'll see a mark on the camshaft sprocket. And you line up those two to get your alignment correct. You do this when the engine is cold. Okay, we're on 4. You do this when the engine is cold. You do not want to do it when the engine is hot. Which one's loose? You can tell that they're loose just by grabbing the rocker arm, moving them up and down. Okay, next thing you're going to do, you're going to get, I'll put a picture up of the intake and exhaust markings. They're typically located on your hood. So looking at the sticker, which is on the hood, valve lash, cold, intake is 0.22 plus or minus 0.02 millimeters. Exhaust is 0.30 plus or minus 0.02 millimeters. So the lash for the exhaust is bigger than the lash for the intake. I picked up these small feeler gauges for my Snap-on guy. This is a 0.012, which equates to 0.305, which will be used for the exhaust. 0.009, the equivalent to 0.229 millimeters, will be used for the intake. Intake, exhaust. Okay, what I've found on these is typically the exhausts are tight and the intakes are loose. So typically when I make the adjustment, I like to make the intakes a little bit tighter and the exhaust just a hair loose. I have this tool that's made specifically for adjusting valves, the lash on the valves, but I never really liked using it. It's just kind of cumbersome and kind of awkward to use. What I like to stick to is just a screwdriver, because you're going to use a screwdriver on the lifter part and a 10 millimeter wrench. 0.22 for the intake. So what I like to do is I'll take the rocker arm, pull it up a little bit. You're going to slip your gauge in there, right? You're going to feel that it drags just a little bit. So you're going to take your feeler gauge and it's just going to drag just a little bit right there. And it'll drag ever so slightly. Okay? If it's too tight or too loose, you'll go in here. This is a 10 millimeter nut. You'll go ahead, you'll break that loose. Okay, break that loose. And I'd like to do this by hand as well. Makes it a little bit easier. Okay, as you're feeling, as you're moving back and forth, you're gonna adjust back the nut up a little bit. And then the actual adjustment is made using this stem right here, the one with the flathead screwdriver mark. And I'll rotate it here. Feeling for a little bit of drag. Want it to drag ever so slightly. And like I said earlier, intakes are usually loose. So when I make the adjustment, I'll make the intake just a little bit tighter. So that feels about good. Maybe back it up just a little bit. Just a little bit of drag. I can't teach you over the video. It's something you have to feel. You're gonna feel the feeler gauge just drag just a little bit when you put it down on there to adjust the lash. Okay, that feels good. Okay, next thing you're gonna do. So once you have the correct adjustment here on the feeler gauge and it's dragging just a little bit, a little bit more. Okay, you're gonna wanna stop the stem from turning, so you bring in your screwdriver, you hold that tight. Don't forget your wrench. Put your wrench on first, because you're gonna have to tighten up the nut. You hold the stem in place while you turn your nut, and the nut locks the adjustment into place. I'm not going to show you how to do each and every one. Then come back in here. The adjustment stayed. Feels good. Intake, exhaust. Take your time on this. Don't rush through it. It's not hard, really, it's not. Just when you set it up, I like to adjust it so the intakes are a little bit tighter and the exhausts are just a little bit loose. When you go back and forth between feeler gauges, make sure you have the correct one. Because that would be a bummer to adjust all this and have the wrong feeler gauge. So like I said, you'll turn the crankshaft bolt, line it up with the next cylinder, and then that's the one you're working on. That feels good to me. It's a little bit tighter than the other one, but I'm gonna leave it because I want my intakes just a hair tight. And I can still drag it out of there, so. Go around, start with your intakes first, do your exhaust, and then turn the crankshaft pulley bolt to your next cylinder, and adjust that one. The rear ones are a little bit more difficult just due to space confinements, space concerns, but it can be done. So like I said, take your time on this. Don't rush through it. Probably looking at like an hour, hour and a half to do the whole six of them. If it's your first time and you're looking to just do it, you're just making minor micro adjustments. It's nothing major. But if it's really close, like this one was, and the feeler gauge moves in and out nicely, a little bit of drag, just leave it alone. Don't even mess with it. If you don't have to, don't adjust it. If it feels good, leave it alone. All right? So then work your way around. Start with the intakes first. Finish with the exhausts. Turn your crankshaft pulley bolt to the next cylinder number, and then work on that one. I'll put a picture up again. Closest to the passenger side, towards the firewall, is number one, number two, number three, four, five, six. And make sure you use the correct feeler gauge for the intake valve and the correct feeler gauge for the exhaust valve. Backlash has been adjusting all the valves on the intakes and the exhaust, bringing in the valve covers now. Got the back one on, bring in the front right now. Okay, gasket is in place, oil tube seals are in place. So go ahead, come down here, make sure everything's out of the way, wiring harness is out of the way, and set it into place. Okay, there it's into place. Here are the bolts, the new rubber gaskets, grommets on it, I should say. The old ones were rock hard, so I had to cut it off. On the tiny one, you'll see when you get in there, I had to use a razor blade to cut it off. But go ahead, start all these by hand. The torque spec for these is 7 foot-pounds. Start all these by hand. You can start tightening them down, but you want to make sure that they're all started by hand first, so that if you need to make an adjustment or move the valve cover just a little bit over on this side, you'll have that room. Because if you tighten this one down, then the whole thing's locked down. So just leave this one loose. Do this one next. Do this one. Just leave them all loose until you're ready to for final torquing. It's exactly the same on the rear valve cover as it is the front. The torque sequence for these, this is number one, this is number two, this is three, this is four, this is five. One, two, three, four, five. At 7 foot-pounds. Okay? This is your only short bolt. The rest of them are long. Another thing to note, don't put the rear cover on the front or the front one on the rear. This one has the oil fill plug. This one back here has the PCV valve. Bring in the torque wrench. This is set to 7 foot-pounds. First in the sequence is number one right here, the short bolt. It's always a good practice to double check. One, two, three, four, five. Okay, another thing, key note, when you take the old rubber grommet off and the bolt is free and clear, there's nothing else on it, before you put the new one on, go ahead, wipe the bolts down, get all that muck and nastiness off of them. Another key note is when you're doing the valve adjustment, and if the engine is moving a little bit quicker than you expect it to, when you're moving the crankshaft pulley bolt, go ahead and remove all the spark plugs, and that'll make it a little bit easier to move the engine and to have it stay in place when you're adjusting the valves on the intake and exhaust on the rocker arms setting the lash. If this gasket is not damaged or hurt in any way, go ahead, reuse it. I'm gonna reuse this one. Pull your rag up. I'm gonna bring in the plenum. We're gonna feed it into the throttle body first. So down on that side, bring that into place. Then you're gonna drop it into the studs. Okay, just like that. Okay, the torque sequence for this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, which is a nut. 8, which is a nut. 9 on the far left is a nut, closest to the passenger side. The actual torque specification for these bolts and nuts is 16 foot-pounds. Just like before with the valve cover, you want to make sure that they all start before you start torquing any one specific bolt down. You might run into problems. That's actually, in any case, when you're doing heads, valve cover gaskets, anywhere there's multiple bolts, you want to start them all by hand first, then walk around and finish them up that way. Because if you tighten one specific one down, then you run the risk of not being able to get the other ones in place. Make sure you take your rag out. I mean, obviously you wouldn't be able to get it down this far if there was a rag there. Number one. Number two. Number three. Number four. Number five. Number six. Now we start onto the nuts. 7, 8, last nut, number 9. Okay, then you go back around, starting from number 1, following the sequence. Just make sure that they're all snug or at the correct specification, because they do, sometimes they get loose when you're putting these many bolts together. Good. Good. 9. All good. Okay. The reason why you want to torque that down is because if you put that on improperly, then you can run the risk of having an air leak. Okay. Next thing we'll do is put the throttle body back into place. Connect your coil packs back up. Put in the connector here. Put your PCV valve back into place. Tighten up the throttle body. Make sure all the connectors are on there. And then we'll fire it up. And I'll show you exactly. When I fire it up, I'll bring you back when I fire it up. Everything's in place. Valve cover, intake manifold, upper plenum, throttle body, all the sensors are in place. Cinched everything down. Only thing left to do is fire it up. So let's fire it up. Do a dummy check real quick. Make sure there's nothing in the way. Don't want anything to get in the way of the belt. All right, let's do it. Valve sounds good. Don't hear any clicking or any major problems. Let this thing run. This Honda Accord J-Series V6, it would start smoking pretty much a minute after you started it because there was so much oil pouring out of the back valve cover. So let this run for a little bit, but I made sure that rear valve cover gasket was seating in place correctly. That's how you guys change the valve covers on a 2000 Honda Accord J-Series V6. This would also work for Acuras, the TL, CL, Honda Odysseys, Ridgeline, Pilots, the majority of Honda Acura vehicles with a J-Series V6 from about 1998 to 2004, as well as applications above that as well. Honda kept this J-Series platform for a long time. It's still in use today in 2016. If you guys want to see a full timing belt video on it, I'll put the links in the description below. If you guys want to see how to do the spark plugs on a J-Series V6, I'll put a link in the description below as well. If you guys have found any of my videos helpful, please consider subscribing to Bundys Garage. Questions, comments, concerns, you can email me at bundysgarage@gmail.com. Try to answer back all comments left on the YouTube channel, as well as emails sent to me. And like always, I'll keep them rolling for you.